This is State of the Unions. I'm Tim Schlittner.
And I'm Julie Green.
We are honored and delighted to be joined by our special guest today, the president of SAG-AFTRA, Gabrielle Carteris. Gabrielle, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me here. I'm very excited.
Thought we'd start by telling listeners a little bit about SAG-AFTRA.
Okay.
What is the SAG-AFTRA union? Who do you represent? Tell us a little bit about people and the men and women in SAG-AFTRA.
All right. So SAG-AFTRA is traditionally known as the Screen Actors Guild of America and the American Federation of Television and Radio Artists. We merged in 2012, and we represent over 160,000 performers in front of the camera, behind the mic, broadcasters, sound recording artists, actors, dancers, singers, pilots who do photography, stunt people. And our members work not only in this country, but we work outside of the country as well. So we want to make sure we have protections no matter where our members work, that they are protected and working under a union contract.
So when I think of SAG-AFTRA, I think of the SAG Awards.
Right.
But the work that you all do is actually much more serious than that. And especially within the last 2 years, the challenges in the industry, the spark of the Me Too movement. Can you just give us some reflections on what that has been like to navigate?
Yes. Well, the SAG Awards are important for the union overall. It's branding, right? And so we know branding is essential, I think, particularly for unions now. It's important for people to understand. And at least this gives the audience a relationship to us. The challenges these last 2 years, it's not just the Harvey Weinstein moment, right? The Me Too movement started over a couple of decades ago, and it's really started with some women of color who came out. Nobody was really listening to them, which is painful, always painful. This resurgence after Harvey Weinstein came up, the Me Too was a rebirth of that group with more voices surrounding it and more people saying, you have to hear us. So clearly it always does take a village. We can't expect one group just to do it alone. That whole period 2 years ago, when our members who actually had the courage to come and speak out on it, which was tremendous. It was an interesting time for me as a woman. I've been in this business for over 35 years. And I, as many other people have felt, men and women, but when I talk to them, that we always felt it was isolated situations or incidences or how much when things would happen, it was like, oh, I'm not going to say anything. I'm a survivor. I'm going to work through it. This moment in time allowed for people to reevaluate and to say, huh, this is not just only me and that we must speak out to help change things. I think it was a really interesting time. And when that explosion happened in the industry and in the country and ultimately the world, because I actually speak around the world with other unions who are dealing with sexual assault, but first came out, the recognition of it's not enough. We're speaking out is only the beginning. How do we really create systemic change was really important. In order for there to be systemic change, we recognized we had to go and implement laws and we had to actually do education and we had to tell people what their rights were. And it was a great opportunity for us. I know where people look at this as like, oh, this is devastating. I actually thought this is an amazing moment. This is a moment where we get to redefine how we communicate, giving people the power to speak up and then to give them the tools so that they can actually help to prevent. So that was when this came out 2 years ago and we started having these discussions and putting panels together and we started working on legislation and we started changing contract language and we started having meetings with members, not only members. The union has been dealing with AFL-CIO. We have the sexual harassment work with women. We're doing that. I do it with FIA, which is the International Labor Organization that supports all the unions and associations around the world that our performers are a part of. And we started having this talk outside of that moment. It's just expanded the talk everywhere. And I think that we've been really effective on implementing in our union. One of the things we see for people who are traumatized, they don't feel like they have a resource, a place to go. So we implemented really the first therapeutic reach out program in our industry for people to call into. We did it in conjunction with the Actors Fund, where people, when they call in and have been in a situation, we can go and refer them to a person or a place to get support, because that's really important so people can move forward. We've also done incredible training with our call-in service, where members, when they call in and they have an issue, we have trained people specifically for this issue now to talk, because, you know, empathy is really important. Hearing people's issues are really important, and then giving them a place to move forward is really important. And it was interesting 2 years ago when it came up, because you'll hear from unions, it's not our job. This is a legal issue, and it's true. It's a legal issue. issue. Mm-hmm. But one of the things we recognized in SAG-AFTRA was that though this is a legal issue, it's illegal to sexually harass, there are laws to help protect people if they report. These are also our members who are in situations that we can actually elevate ourselves to help them. And we wanted to be able to step out a little bit. It's hard to step out of that place where you're kind of protected. You don't have to do it, but we really do morally have to do it. I think what's incredible is the people who have gotten involved to support us through this. Mm-hmm. The members are really engaged. And now it's just knowing that it never ends. We're just going to keep working and working to reach out to change the language and contracts to protect our members on-set and off-set. That was a big thing. We don't have jurisdiction outside of the workplace, but a lot of our members are being assaulted in the process of getting work, whether it's with directors or producers or writers when they're doing the initial meeting. So we're creating these rules to protect them so that they don't have to say, I won't do this. They say, my union won't allow it.
You've been in the business for over 30 years. Can you talk a little bit about what you've experienced or witnessed when it comes to sexual harassment? Was it prevalent on sets? Is it something that occurred, like you said, when people were in the process of searching for work? How prevalent was it?
It is still. I really need to say this. This is not a male-female issue. I say this. There are good men and good women out there who are really fighting the fight. Some of my experience actually of harassment came from women.
Wow.
From one agent who said to me when I was younger, and it's not the same I've had where there's sexual things that have happened, but even the suggestion, this business is about tits and ass, which you have neither of. Or I had an agent said, you know, you just got to show more, Gabrielle. You got to whatever. And these are all messages that come to us in ways that it's inappropriate. I always used to say, what about my work? Because you can dress me up to look like whatever, but do you want to see my work? The work I do is so visual. That when I first started in the business, it was really all blondes. I always say blonde, blue-eyed, big-breasted women. That was the ideal. Nowadays, we're looking at, and this is important, sexual harassment and assault, or really the taking of somebody's power. That idea happens because we actually exist in all different forms outside of that. So when we don't represent fully everybody, we create vulnerability. For the people who are underrepresented, they're more at risk because they feel they have less of a voice. And that's why when I think of unionism and I think of what we do, the idea is if we can reflect the real world out there with diversity and inclusion and really have everybody up there, then there's going to be less of the divide. That's creating equality.
Yeah, it's a fascinating perspective. And I guess I wonder, how far have we come? That's one of the questions. SAG-AFTRA is obviously at the front of the fight, but like, how far have we come? Not only in the last 30 years, but in the last 2 years.
I was going to say 2 years, definitely not very far in 30 years. And I have to say, as far as we've come, we haven't come far enough. So I wouldn't measure how far we've come. I think we should just continue moving. I don't think that measuring will help us because the truth is this has gone on for centuries. So it would be a false impression to think that we're going to change it all right in this moment. I think it's progressive, but I think the work here at the AFL-CIO, putting a code of conduct, that's great. There's a great guy, his name is Ted Bunch, who speaks to men about this issue. He works with A Call to Men. He's fabulous. You can see him on YouTube. I've spoken with him when I've been asked to come speak. I'll ask him to come because I think the male-female dynamic is really important. And it's great for men. They don't want to necessarily hear from me, right? But a man hearing from a man, not being told they're wrong or right, but saying, you know what, maybe our perceptions are skewed because of the way we're raised. And have you considered this? And he tells stories. I was at a really important meeting in Chicago and I brought him there, all lawyers, 500. And the men, some of them cried.
Wow.
They cried when he spoke because he spoke truth. The way that we're going to change what you're asking, like how far have we come? We're only going to really be able to change if we really have the real conversations, not the punishing conversations. Yeah. People should be held accountable. But I think also we have to change our dynamic. We can't be afraid to like say, God, are we making people so self-conscious that they're not participating in life? I think we have to keep talking about it. We just have to keep doing that. And that's challenging because people just want sometimes an outcome. But I think it's not possible to have any outcome if you think it's going to be immediate. It's just a part of our being. And we have a lot to do to grow. And we'll have to keep doing that. Mm-hmm. And the minute we stop, then we fail.
I think what's been so fascinating about it for me just to watch and you think about like how far we've come in the last 30 years and the last 2 years, one of the not unintended consequences but results of this has been this real sense of community, right, among the survivors, the victims, and at least there's that and that place for them to go to. The trauma that comes with it is significant, but you referenced this within the AFL-CIO and our own organization. You, Secretary Treasurer Liz Schuler, and the Women's Committee really were leaders in driving our own code of conduct that we have now that we read before the start of every single meeting. What's it been like for you?
It's interesting. So when I first got involved with the AFL-CIO, I did it on the state level first. And I was struck struck. First of all, very, very interesting people. But I must say, all people of a certain type.
Yeah.
I was really struck by that. And I was struck by that when I came to the table. And I talked about it in the room. Mm-hmm. And I've said, if we are going to walk this walk and we're going to say we represent the working people, I said, then they need to be at the table. And that's not just one group. There are many groups. And that is really great today when I was in meetings to hear people say we need to be bringing people to the room. And we are talking about people of color, LGBTQ. We're mm-hmm. talking about women. We're talking about young people. Mm-hmm. We can't tell people what it's going to be like for them that we're there to support them. We have to be there with each other making it happen. So it's been very interesting for me. I'm very proud that we did put together a code of conduct. I do think that we have to keep doing more. And I think it's uncomfortable. The truth is, I think it's just uncomfortable. And I know there's a lot of different voices in the room and we don't want to offend. And I really appreciate all of that. But that being said, we have a responsibility. And I think if we can face that truth together, we will be effective. We will make a difference. And in the end, I think we're here to do that.
So you've used your seat to bring up an uncomfortable topic a mm-hmm. couple of times, and that's mergers. And yes. In the meeting today, you talked about humble courage mm-hmm. of merging two unions together. Mm-hmm. And you faced a little bit of pushback from some people mm-hmm. at that table that say it's too hard. Can you talk about the SAG-AFTRA merger, how it came about, and what the impact yeah. has been, and why you've used your seat to advocate for more consolidation?
So our unions, like I said, we used to be Screen Actors Guild and American Federation of Television and Radio Artists. So that was SAG and AFTRA, two separate unions. I was in both of those unions, being actually as the change of our industry, as we started to get digitized, the lines were being blurred of who covered what. And so what I was doing myself and many others, we were doing duplicate work, paying two unions. Some people weren't making enough to make their insurance, but even though they made enough to live because they were making two different incomes from two different contracts.
You paid dues to two different unions.
That's what we did. Two different unions. We had so different health plans, different pension plans. And I thought it was ludicrous. There were several attempts before we had successfully merged the unions in 2012. And it was always this feeling of we're actors, we're film actors, we're artists. We don't want to be with broadcasters. We don't want to be with dancers or singers or whatever. My big thing was, hold up, don't define me. I don't want my unions to define my work. I want to work and I want to have one place where I pay and I want to get protected. Our unions, when we were not together, even though we did joint negotiations together, the employer still played us against each other.
Right.
And so what happened was in 08, I came together with a group of people saying, we want to come in here and we want to really merge the unions. And there was a lot of pushback from members again, who were really, that's not who we are. That's not what we do. And I said, I don't know what you do, but I know that the future is me being able to do everything. And I want to be supported in one place and I don't want to feel whipsawed. I don't want that. And there were a lot of us who talked about it. So we started coming into the boardroom and we started talking to members around the country, really saying what would work for you, what wouldn't work. We got together a group called the G1 group to form one union. And it was leaders from both unions, Ken Howard and Roberta Reardon, and came together and they said, we want to go and explore this with you. And so we would travel the country and talk to members and have meetings. And we started to talk about what the benefits were. We really were educating them instead of living in a mythology about why it's not good to merge. We talked to them about the benefits of merging. We'll be stronger. We'll be one voice in the room. We won't be able to be separated that way. We'll be able to have one health plan so we can keep it strong. We'll have one pension ultimately. We can't even explore the pensions. We're still two separate pensions, but we cannot explore the merging of pensions or creation of a new pension as long as we're divided. Once we come together, we're forced into doing that. Those are important things for the future. So we went and we really worked hard on communicating and listening. And then in 2012, we were able to successfully merge the unions. And I have to say, I was told then we had a facilitator from Rutgers with us at the time because we needed that facilitation because we had a lot of different opinions and you got to get to a solution.
Yeah.
You can't keep floating until everybody's in agreement. You want everybody to be in some kind of understanding, someplace that we can come together. So we had a great facilitator. And she said to me at the time of merging, we were writing the new constitution. We were sequestered for several weeks into a space doing the work that we would present to the membership so they could vote up or down the merger. And she said, so Gabrielle, are you planning to stay? And I said, oh my God, this work has been so hard. When we're merged, I'm done. And she said, no. She said, if you merge, she said, that's when the work begins and it will take you 5 years to stabilize. And so you have to be willing to commit to that. And that was a real like, oh my God, I'm so tired, really?
So we're at 7 years
seven
now.
7 years.
How's the stabilization going?
It's been tremendous for us. But I will say that there are people who still remember fondly those good old days. And when I look at them, I'm thinking, are you really remembering those good old days? Because right now we have one health plan. More people are actually able to receive health healthcare through our plans. Mm-hmm. As a result, more people are participating in a pension. We have safety in the organizing that we've done, where broadcasters weren't so sure, why should we go with Screen Actors Guild? They don't want broadcasters. And what benefit? We've done so well on behalf of the broadcasters in organizing new shops, public radio and TV. Mm-hmm. These are things that happened because we were not distracted anymore. The merger was successful for us because we were finally able to work together and focus on what we wanted to build. And I think that we have done really great work. The one thing is, though, like sexual harassment, like everything else, it doesn't stop. It's something that you can never sit on the laurels of thinking we've gotten there. It's just, there's so much work to be done. So how well we've done, I think we've done great. Can we do better? We can always continue doing better, and we must do better. Mm-hmm. And so our last negotiation for our commercials contract, one of the strongest negotiations we've had, I think it was because we didn't have the distraction of being divided. Even though we used to jointly negotiate together, we still had our own personal issues. Now it's all one. And we did a great deal with Netflix. I think that that would not have been something that was offered to both unions at that time. Being one place for this number of members who represent such a large performing community, I think is really meaningful and helps.
And what did you mean by humble courage?
It takes courage, first of all, because you have to be able to do the work, and you got to be able to hear people and have to be humbled by hearing what's not working. That is humbling, right? Because you want to say it's all roses and sugar sweet, and it's not. It's hard. I think if you really understand that and really kind of breathe for a moment and say, you know, that's what makes it humbling. It's never finished. Mm-hmm. So that's humbling, isn't it? Because even in your successes, you have to know there's more to do. That's humbling. That it's just never quite enough. But I think that it's so important. It's frightening. I say this to my girls all the time. Everybody has fear. Yeah. That's okay. It's living with courage despite our fear. Mm-hmm. And I think that I would say that to everybody here. When I talk in the AFL-CIO, it's just, despite our fear, we must lead with courage. And I think merging and coming together, ideally, all workers would be under a union support system. But in order for us to do that, sometimes you have to also be humble enough to know you got to change things.
We've been having this ongoing conversation about the future of work. Mm. And there's an actual commission, and you referenced it before, you're one of the sector chairs. And one of the things I've always been curious about in your industry in particular is, how has like reality television kind of come in? Because we talk about automation and automatic checkouts kind of taking the place. And it seems like one of the hallmarks of reality TV is you can shoot anytime, anywhere. Like there is no contract to dictate hours or pay or
Well, some reality. I did Surreal Life when it first started. That was contract, SAG-AFTRA contract. So I did do that. I've been offered other shows, and I won't do it unless it is. Mm-hmm. So parts of the reality shows are covered and some aren't. But reality shows, I mean, that's just a style.
Yeah.
I think the technology that affects us is something much bigger than that. Mm-hmm. We have, with the advent of just the kind of cameras that are being created at home, people are going to be able to do 3D virtual reality.
Yeah.
People can do virtual reality shooting for virtually nothing. And that's going to change everything. We know that the idea of, we call them deep fakes, where we can take your face and put it on, for instance, we're fighting this legislatively for pornography. Mm. You can't differentiate. You don't know that that face has been pasted on that body doing things that you don't want to do. Or you saw Star Wars, right? Mm-hmm. We had Carrie Fisher passed away, and still she was the entire character out there because they were able to digitally put her in. That's the technology we're facing. Wow. The idea that we want to protect intellectual property. We want to be able to protect our images. Mm. We represent sound recording artists. How do we protect them? You look at the technology, 3D cameras or holographic cameras where concerts can happen here at the same time they could happen in California or in Paris. It's growing faster and faster, like every other organization, every other working group. And we're looking to find ways to partner with technology so that we can go and at least teach our members what the future looks like so that they can go and prepare and actually maybe be the creators of that content. We want them to continue working and creating and not to only think linearly the way it's always been, but what will it be? And I think that makes us relevant to young people because that's where they're going to be doing. They're not going to be, oh, it's always been done this way. They're going to say, oh, I don't care how it was done. This is how I'm going to do it. I'm so excited. So I think the technology touches us in a much deeper place than it does with just reality TV. Reality TV, again, is a style. Game shows, reality TV. There's always these niches that go on, but it's an interesting time, definitely.
What was your pathway to joining SAG or AFTRA? I don't know which one came first, but
it actually came about the same time when I was just out of college. And it was at a time when unions were very strong. You couldn't work without being union. Mm. And it was a real badge of honor. For me, it still is. I love being a part of my union. And I love being, I guess, a part of the labor movement. For me, has been really, talk about service. It's just an incredible honor. But when I first joined the unions, I didn't realize that members were a part of it. I thought it was, the union was a separate entity that negotiated contracts for me. And the contracts I had, they were great contracts. Mm-hmm. So I never questioned how they came to be. I didn't question my protections and how they were created. How were they enforced? I didn't look at any of that. And about 11 years ago, I was shooting a movie in Vancouver and I was in a fight scene. I was partially paralyzed and I lost my ability to speak. And I had movement disorders. I had to stop for a couple of years. And during that period of healing, I was invited to be on the board of AFTRA and didn't realize the involvement. And then I started to work with members. And then I got onto the board of SAG. And then as I got better, I had been hooked, right? Because that's kind of what it's like, right? You kind of, you don't think about it. And then you get into it. And then your passion in your heart and you're fighting the good fight.
Then you're all in.
Yeah. And then it's it, right? So you're all in. The hook happened. Yeah. And that's really for me how it began. And so I always say, when God closes a door, she opens a window.
That's right. That's right.
Well, so do you see that injury as a blessing?
I absolutely do. I see it as a blessing in so many ways. And I look at, I'm here today and I'm still working and I'm having a full family life. And I had the opportunity to discover my union service. So that's pretty amazing.
Really cool. The last contract you negotiated with film and TV, that's coming up again next
TV
year?
TV theatrical is coming up.
Yeah. Yes, so what are the big issues facing SAG-AFTRA?
So I can't talk about negotiations because we're now with our committee together, so I can't talk about what's going on, but we are dealing with the technology of the industry and you know, we see streaming and what's taking place and the compression of salaries and it's like everything. What we are facing is what the labor force is. More work, less time, less money, more work. And so how do you make sure that the members are being fairly compensated for the work that's being used? If people are making money on the work that people do, we want to make sure that that's across the board. And so that's the lens in which we look at negotiations. I believe in being very strategic when we do negotiations. It's not enough to ever just go in and say, this is what we deserve and slam the table. I think that that is not a win. I think the real work comes in really listening to what are not only our concerns, what are the concerns of the employers? And then to be able to listen to that and say, where can we go and meet? Even though we have to make sure, because this is the most important, obviously, is to make sure that our members receive what they deserve and they're protected. We also want to keep a thriving industry. We want it to be thriving. And so we need to find ways to also support the changes that are happening with our employers. So that's really kind of the quest as we move forward, is really communicating and having these conversations with them, doing a lot of research to see the changes so that we're not behind trying to catch up, but we're in the cutting edge of when we negotiate. So we're looking at, in terms of technology and whatever, we're looking at that. And so we try to implement that within our contracts.
Is there anxiety among the membership about streaming?
It's a challenge. Maybe it's anxiety. I think it's knowing that there's a major change. It's not just appointment television anymore. It's to be three, almost four networks, right? ABC, CBS, NBC, and then Fox. And now it's not that. There are many different platforms. So I think that the anxiety comes in like not recognizing this happens so quickly. Mm-hmm. And then are we on top of it? And realizing what are the steps we need to take to be on top of it? When people feel anxious, what happens is they want immediate change. And then you have to say, how do we change it? Not to address just today, but to the future, because you don't want to change so quickly that what you've done is locked yourself into something that's still changing. You don't want to be on the bottom end of it, right? You don't want to say, well, we changed right away, but we didn't imagine it was going to go here. And now there's no place to go.
Right. I feel like that when I get an iPhone.
Right. I know,
because
right?
It's always like, I got the new one. Right. I'm all set. And then there's 11.
Thing. Yeah. It's true. It's And so that's really,
good analogy.
It's the perfect analogy. Yeah. And so it's a fine balance. And it's, what do we change? What do we leave open? I think this is a very, very significant negotiation, but we'll be ready.
Well, I think they're in good hands with you at the helm.
I recently asked the building trades if they see employers as partners or adversaries. I thought I'd give you the same question.
I think that they must be our partners. I think that sometimes it's adversarial, but I think that's also the way we communicate. Mm-hmm. I think we have to find a new way to communicate. And we do that. We do pre-negotiation things that we never really historically did the same way. I don't know. I guess I wouldn't want to label it that way. But look, my job is to protect our members. But I also believe that in order to protect our members and to make sure that people have a strong livelihood, we have to understand what the issues are of our employers. To think there are no issues is actually sometimes the way you can victimize yourself, right? Mm-hmm. We can empower ourselves by really seeing the truth. What was their response?
Partners.
Yeah.
But they also said that that from time to time there is an adversarial relationship, but they see their partner's success as their success. Right. And like you talked about wanting to have a thriving industry, they want to have a thriving industry. And, you know, value on display every day is their motto. So they want to be indispensable to their employers. Right. And I think in many ways, you guys are the same.
Yeah, I think it's absolutely.
We talked through a lot of the challenges that the labor movement's facing. What do you see as the opportunities?
I think this is an incredible opportunity from the Me Too movement, you know, the whole explosion actually 2 years ago. I see with youth, young people are more engaged now than ever. They see themselves as the changers. It's one thing as an adult to say to a child or to a young person, you know, the future is yours to do, right? That's one thing. But for them to be able to say, the future is mine to do. And I think that we are seeing this in so many ways. With you know, the shootings that have gone on, it's empowered young people to have a voice. With the elections, no matter how you lean in terms of your politics, you're seeing more young people getting involved saying, do not decide for me and then tell me I have to live with your choice. I will decide for me, and I will not just stand here and be yes to death. I want to see action and proof. That is amazing. So I see that as major shifts.
Great.
So one of the first times I witnessed collective action was on Beverly Hills 90210. So we could spend a couple of minutes talking about that, the Donna Martin graduates scene. So how did you come to be on that show? Did you have dreams of being a union president or an actress or something else?
I told you, I didn't know they people were a member of the union that way. Look, I was older playing somebody younger and I lived in New York. I wanted to learn the business side. So I went to LA for what they call pilot season. And I auditioned for a show called Class of Beverly Hills, which later became Beverly Hills 90210. And I went in and it was a long process, this audition. I mean, it's really an interesting experience. It's a different form of job hunting, for sure. I went through a lot of different things to, I don't know if you want the whole story, but when I finally did get this job, I had been offered 6 degrees of separation at Lincoln Center at the same time and another TV show with Dr. Ruth Westheimer on Sexually Speaking. And I was offered another play and it was Feast or Famine in our industry. And I chose this show called 90210.
Good choice.
Said, I know, right?
Who knew?
And my manager at the time was like, you should take the Dr. Ruth show, Gabrielle, because it's already guaranteed 6 episodes. It's going to shoot in New York. You don't have to move. And I was like, oh, I don't know. I don't. First of all, I didn't love the show. Mm-hmm. And I said, secondly, I said, Aaron Spelling. I mean, do you know, he's been like, he's everything he touches is gold. I'm going to go and take that leap of faith. Well, thank God. Oh, my God. Who would have ever thought something like that could change a life? The absolute trajectory of my life was shaped by that experience. And it allowed me to come into my leadership. I think that it's meaningful for the members to see me doing the work in a way that they can identify. I think that being on this show, getting that opportunity, it just changed my life in so many ways. And I will always be grateful for it. Never resented it. Even when that's all people could see me as Andrea, didn't matter.
What was the age difference between you and your character?
I was 29. I was playing the role of a 16-year-old, 17-year-old.
Oh, wow. What's it been like shooting the reboot?
We just finished shooting the reboot and it was really hard, really exciting, really liberating. For us, a lot of it was full circle.
Because
we were, even though I was older than they were, it was still one of my first real jobs. Mm-hmm. And we were traumatized. The show became very successful very quickly and our private lives suddenly were just taken from us. Yeah. And it was so interesting how at the time there was a lot of the producers trying to play us against each other because divided it's easier, just like in the union, right?
Wow.
And so how we came together this time is we said, this is a different time and this is all for one and one for all. And we are all here together. We're not going to let them divide us. And it's been really so wonderful. And being in union service actually gave me a voice so that when I went to work this time around, I was okay to say, you know what, guys, let's do it this way. I'm going to stand by you. Will you stand there with me? And where I was a little afraid when I was younger, they say, if I knew then what I know now, how great that would be. But I really felt so grateful for my service. I think it really helped me to really take this experience to its fullest. It was wonderful to shoot with everybody. I feel very blessed. I feel honored to have done it. And I don't know what's going to happen, but it was, for some of us, it was really healing. And it's nice after a long period of time to be able to come back to something you love and say, you know what? I know this.
Yeah.
We were very sorry to hear about Luke Perry. Yeah. Had he planned to be in the show?
He was on Riverdale. Gabrielle. So he was going to do guest with us, but he had been a part of the conversation. So I was actually doing work with Luke union stuff prior to his passing. And it was sad. I think that we paid tribute to him well. Mm-hmm. And I think that when something goes on, I say, oh, that was Luke. He was making that happen. Right? So he's with us, definitely. But it's been a journey.
What would you say are the similarities and differences between you at that age and the character, Andrea?
From when I did it the first time?
Yeah.
Well, I think what happened was, and I do think that with a show's success, they start to take from the personalities. Mm. I think that initially, not so alike, but I think as time went on, they really, for all of us, started to take pieces of us. How do you keep longevity? You have to have something that feels honest. Authentic. So I think there are elements of all of us in our characters. And I think that's fun too. And this has been fun, the reboot, because we're not in the reboot part yet. For anybody who's been watching it, we're in this pseudo-tend real world time. I was just on a flight yesterday coming here, and they were saying, I was sitting next to a gentleman who said, I've been watching with my wife. He said, but I'm just not sure. Is that real or is this real? Is that real? And I thought that was funny. That was like, that's interesting. That's what we wanted. And it was,
that's great.
It was a time of people feeling coming home. I think we're living in a very complicated time politically. I think people are feeling lost and they long for familiarity. So it was coming home for a lot of us.
Well, Gabrielle Carteris, president of SAG-AFTRA, thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you for everything you're doing.
Thank you.
Your voice has been a breath of fresh air. It's been fun to see you at the AFL-CIO table, and we hope you're there for many more years.
This has been State of the Unions. Thanks for listening. Join us every other week for a conversation about the labor movement, organizing, and all things that affect us at work.
Make sure you never miss an episode by subscribing and rating us on iTunes, Google Play, or wherever you get your podcasts. And until next time, keep up to date on all things labor by following us on Twitter at AFL-CIO.